How to Watch, ESPN, 7 p.m. In the United States Open Women's Singles Semifinals on Thursday night, Serena Williams plays Elena Svitolina, and Belinda Bencic faces Bianca Andreescu. First set, Williams 4, Svitolina 1. After Svitolina got on the board with a hold in the fourth game, Williams has held onto her advantage, saving three more break points, from 0-40 down, to go up by 4-1. Perhaps showing her ease at the moment, Williams saved the second with a serve and volley, the first time in the entire tournament she has used that tactic. First set, Williams 3, Svitolina 0. The first two games of the first US Open semi-final were battles. Williams, serving to open, needed to fend off three break points before holding. In Svitolina's opening service game, she double-faulted on two game points and then staved off two break points before Williams converted the third to go up 2-0, smacking an easy backhand return winner off a 79 mph second serve. The third game was far simpler for Williams, who held at love to bring the match to its first changeover after 18 minutes. She sat down with a 3-0 lead as thousands of fans who had been waiting in the stadium corridors scurried to their seats. Among Serena Williams's best skills as she asserted herself as the best player of her generation was her closing ability. In her first 28 Grand Slam semi-final appearances, Williams went on to win the title 21 times, a 75% conversion rate. Yet starting with her loss to Roberta Vinci in the 2015 US Open semifinals, Williams has won only two titles out of nine major semifinal appearances, a 22% conversion rate. In her search for her record-tying 24th Grand Slam singles title, Williams has reached four finals since returning from the birth of her daughter and lost them all. Williams has dropped only one set on her way to the semi-final to the 17-year-old Katty McNally in the second round. She has two notable routs, a 6-1, 6-1 win over Maria Sharapova in the first round, and a 6-1, 6-0 victory over Wang Qiang in the fourth. Williams, seeded 8th at this year's Open, is 4-1 against the 5th-seeded Elena Svitolina. But Svitolina, a 24-year-old from Ukraine, won their last meeting, in the third round of the 2016 Rio Olympics. They have not played since Williams, 37, left the tour for maternity leave and Svitolina became a fixture in the top 10. Svitolina reached the semifinals of a major for the first time at Wimbledon in July. She lost to the eventual champion, Simona Halep, 6-1, 6-3. But she has been well prepared for the challenge of facing Williams by this year's draw, which has forced her to navigate a barrage of power players in her last four rounds: Venus Williams, number 32 Diana Yastremska, number 10 Madison Keys, and number 16 Johanna Konta. Svitolina has not lost a set in the tournament. Svitolina said that practicing with her boyfriend, the French tennis star Gael Monfils, had helped her prepare to face big hitters on the women's tour. Thursday's second semi-final will feature two first-time Grand Slam semi-finalists, as the 13th-seeded Belinda Bencic, 22, will face 15th-seeded Bianca Andreescu, 19, in a match between prodigies who could have arrived to this stage even faster, if not for injuries. Though they have never played, they will recognize much in each other. Bencic won the 2015 Rogers Cup in Toronto at 18, Andreescu won the title there last month, at 19. Both are known for preternatural court sense and comfort playing all court games. Ranked 100 set of tornadoes and a high risk of dangerous flash floods. While inland and river flooding were likely, Mr. Cooper said, the worst of the storm's effects will be on the coast until the storm clears the Outer Banks tomorrow. Many vacationers had already left Outer Banks communities, and locals were scrambling to pack up their belongings as the wind started to pick up Thursday afternoon. Billy's Seafood, a mom-and-pop store known for its fresh fish, soft-shell crabs, and tuna salad, was closing up shop after moving its supplies several feet off the floor. "We were just getting ready to leave," Judy Beasley, who owns the store with her family, said when reached by telephone Thursday afternoon. Hurricanes are deeply interwoven with the history of the Carolinas. Massive storms complicated the efforts to establish the first permanent English colony in the Americas at Roanoke Island, on North Carolina's Outer Banks, in the 1580s. The settlement was later abandoned for reasons that remain a mystery. In South Carolina, the devastation of Hurricane Hugo in 1989 still lingers as a life-defining trauma for many coastal residents. At the time, it was the costliest hurricane in the United States, costing roughly $7 billion in damage. It was also a pivotal moment for the city of Charleston, knocking down or badly damaging numerous buildings. The damage was an opportunity for thoughtful urban revitalization spearheaded by then-Mayor Joseph P. Riley Jr., and sparked Charleston's modern-day renaissance as a tourist-saturated coastal jewel. Mr. Cornock, the oysterman, came to the Carolinas in 1994, but his wife's family, whose roots in McClellanville date to the 19th century, carry the trauma of Hugo. On Thursday, they had their valuables off of the first floor, the storm shutters closed, the windows boarded. He was worried that the storm's western flank might arrive with the afternoon high tide, flooding everything. "We're right on the creek, and when the surge hits you, you won't know it until the water starts rising," he said. "It might go from no water to the waters at your front door." The coastal Carolinas offer a number of challenges in the midst of a storm. Some of the barrier islands in the Outer Banks are difficult to access. This summer, officials in Dare County dredged a channel to ensure that an emergency ferry could pass between Rodanthe, on a sliver of Barrier Island, and the mainland town of Stumpy Point. Bridges on and off of coastal land masses can become dangerous to cross in high sustained winds, as they were in Charleston County Thursday. And in the flat, low-lying city of Charleston, moving storm water out of the city is dependent upon the tide cycle. At high tide, pipes and ditches are full of seawater, leaving storm water with no place to go until the tide recedes. In Wilmington, North Carolina, last year, Hurricane Florence washed out the highways that lead into the city, effectively turning it into a temporary island of 122,000 people, and the new storm approached as the city still appeared to be getting over Florence. Blue tarps still cover many roofs, and contractors are in high demand. Some residents had tried to speed up work on their homes to get them ready for Dorian this week. Stephen Still, the county's director of emergency management, twice referred to Dorian as Florence at a news conference earlier in the week, until a commissioner grabbed his arm and mouthed, "Dorian. It still feels like we're responding to Florence, even though this storm is different in many ways," Mr. Still said in an interview Thursday. But lessons had been learned, thanks in part to an internal county report that found gaps in the local government's response to Florence. Before Dorian, faith-based groups and volunteer organizations knocked on doors in flood-prone areas to give residents a heads-up. At Codington Elementary School, 115 people had filled the shelter to capacity by Wednesday night. Inside, children played in the cafeteria and adults passed the time with games and chatter. Katie Meekins, 72, and her husband had taken Hurricane Florence seriously, evacuating for 10 days. This time around, the couple stayed in their house, thinking the storm might veer east into the ocean. But Thursday morning, they watched as a tornado emerged in their golf course community of Porter's Neck, and as trees fell on their house and that of a neighbor. The couple had moved to Greater Wilmington for a laid-back retirement, Ms. Meekins said, but during hurricane season it had proven to be anything but. "We've been okay with this," she added, indicating they were not sure how long they could keep it up. "But I'd assume that in another 10 years, we won't."